Hi, and welcome to Basket Making with Cheryl and Edie. And I'm Edie. This afternoon, we're going to take all the step-by-step lessons that I've been videotaping with Cheryl, and we're going to take that and put it all together and make our basic round basket. Hi, Cheryl.
Hey. If you pre-ordered a kit, then you should have all of your pieces from the kit, and you can get them all ready, get your reed wet, get it all laid out like we have. This is from the first steps on how to mark the spokes and get things so that you'll be in a circle. So if you need to go back and review the basic start, you need to do that, because we're not going to concentrate so much on the intricate details because we have already done that. We have twining for the bottom. I'm going to hold up the bottom of the basket. So we have the twining, and then we have weavers here that we're going to do on the sides. We have some color that we're going to be putting in, and then we have a pre-cut piece of smaller for the last row underneath the rims. We have our rim pieces, and we have our seagrass and lashing. This makes it a lot easier to just get everything cut, wet, and ready, so that when you're ready to sit down and weave, you can sit down and relax and have a good time without saying, oh my gosh,
gotta do this, I forgot this,
where's this, that, or the other. So this has been in the warm water for about 5 minutes, and we have marked our spokes and we have our circles lined up. I'm going to move these out of the way a little bit. If we had a cameraman for us that could zoom in,
give you just a hair more room there if you need it.
Okay. That would be great, but we don't.
No, we don't.
So we deal with it. We're not we're not professionals behind the camera. Although I understand a lot of people are going with that profession now and being very successful. Anyway, with the very first basket, the square basket that was taught. Go under your center one.
Line it up with my...
Right. The one that's under, you lay it on top of the mark.
Okay.
And then it's twisted. And then you go under the next. And then what you can do is you can turn the bottom as you go. So the piece that went under this one is on top of the mark here. And then this goes under. So once you get a rhythm going, you can turn the bottom and weave the piece of round reed basically at the same time. Now, from the perspective I am at, and I'm not sure how high your chair is, but mine seems really low for me.
Yes, me too.
And I don't know if that's because I'm so tall.
I think it might be easier to almost stand.
Well, I tend to stand, but I also tend to do this. I also tend to, after I get the first row in like this, then I just weave like it's on its side.
Okay.
Or if I'm standing, I'll hang the edges of the spokes over the side of the table. Now, if I were doing a really, really wide bottom, I'd probably stand up and do it. That's what I always tell my students, and about 9 times out of 10, they stand up.
Yeah, sometimes, you know, you just got to find out what's comfortable for you so you can see what you're doing. And because your spokes will move a little bit.
We need the basket so that we can find out how much wider we're going to be. So I'm going to measure from the outside to the outside, and that is approximately 6 inches. And he just convinced me to stand up too. So when they say you can hang the edges of the spokes over the table, you can do that. And then
All right, now I'm getting ready to do the step up, I believe.
No.
No?
No
step up on this. Okay, just keep twining.
Yep.
All right.
Basic twining. Remember in the detailed video that I show you if you take this in the wrong sequence, you don't make this touch this one and have this one go under, how it can be wrong. So pay attention to that, that you don't have two that are running together side by side. They should like look like every other. You can also, excuse me, if you take that one under and you tend to allow that one to go under first, just hold on to that. I decided on this basket to have a little bit smaller pie-shaped holes than this one, so I will be doing a few more rows of the round reed. And that's just because I had a really nice long piece. I am going to measure now. I'm back to the beginning where I started it, where I started that fold and hooked it over. That only measures about 4.5. So I'm going to go a little farther. Back to the beginning now, again, where my little loop is. And I'm almost out of this. I can't go around another time. And that is almost right on the money.
Once you get this down and you're moving around, excuse me, it goes really fast.
Ended up going a total of 5 rows. Are you that far yet?
I think I'm at what, 4?
You're at 4. And
so
you should have enough.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm ending this. And again, if you need a refresher on how to end that twining, go back to that video. Crimping that with my little crimpers to break down the fibers. I'm using my tool to make some space in there. Now I'm going to use this tool to bend this because it's really short and nearly impossible to just get in there with my fingers. So that's a nice, neat little tuck right there. And then this one will tuck in the same way. So, Edie, you go past one, past your starter, and here, you want to re-wet that.
Okay.
And then,
so my bottom?
That's your starter, so mm-hmm. You're going to want to go one past that and cut it right at the edge.
Okay.
And this one will be cut right at that edge. Then you're going to crimp. You're going to be crimping right down here. And then insert your tool there. Use your tool. It's much easier than your fingers. No, you're. So your flat tip goes in and up so that it makes space in there. And then your little needle nose you can use to help shove that in there. That part's probably easier to sit down and do.
Yes.
Which we can do that now.
Yes,
once we're finished. So let's have a seat.
Yes.
So then you're going to tuck the next one in on the other side.
Gotcha. Gotcha, gotcha. You ever have that moment when all eyes are on you?
Yep.
I'm having one.
Everybody's watching.
Everybody's watching what I'm doing.
Okay, the next step is to turn up the sides or upset the sides, whatever. And I think on this small round basket, this is the easiest way to do it. I can't remember if we did the upsetting on the round or we put the one for the square on this one. But regardless, when you upset or turn up the sides of the basket, if you are going to have a flat bottom like we want for this basket, this is the way you do it. If you're not going to make a flat bottom, if you're going to make a rounded bottom, you don't upset the sides like this. And that's a whole nother technique in another class. It's like a little bird cage now, or a teepee. You can tie some suede up here and put a little bird nest. But instead, I'd rather make a basket. So make sure that you don't pick up your rim material and that it have four pieces in it. Make sure you get your,
that's fine.
Your 3/8.
Yep.
Alright, so we're weaving these rows with the 3/8. If you need to stop and refer back to the lesson on the first, I think we have how to weave the first row, mm-hmm. and a separate one how to weave the second, and then the third and fourth, and then into the color. So remember to check for the bad side of the reed. And if you need a refresher, you just...
Is there any particular spoke that we're going to choose?
Nope. It really doesn't matter on these.
All right.
Oh, wait a minute, though. I'm trying to do it the hard way. Remember, on this basket, it's easier to do it away from yourself.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's how I show it in the video. Because it is. So, but go the other direction. The other direction. This time you're going to go from right to left on the outside, because when you turn it around, it's correct.
Oh.
Okay. So clothespin, and then do your under, over, and when you feel the need to secure it with a clothespin, which for me it's about not quite halfway around, clothespin at the bottom. That might look a little awkward because of the way I just kind of pushed those all in. But now I want to put a clothespin on that one to help secure it up. And now I'm back to the beginning. And I'm going to overlap four spokes. And I go over that very carefully. So I want to make sure I have a clothespin over here with the fourth one, because when I take this one off, I don't want it to just fly apart and lose it like I could have. So that's number one.
Two, three, four.
Wait. So you make sure you have a clothespin on the fourth one. No, that's not one. One is your first one.
One.
That's one.
One, two, three, four.
Okay, so put a clothespin on the fourth one. I'm showing Edie how to do it much easier, because if you don't, you'll be frustrated with it. So now, lay that in there. Take that clothespin off. Okay, now tighten that piece a little bit. Snug it up. Okay, now put the clothespin back on. There you go. Now, take this clothespin off.
Okay.
Lay this right over here and cut it where you're going to want it to tuck.
Okay. One, two, three, four on this one.
No. This is one.
This is four.
Right. Your fourth one should end underneath one.
Right.
Your first one starts on the outside of one. Your fourth one ends on the inside so that you can't see the start
right. Of
the finish. So that can be really confusing. And if you count incorrectly, then you go too far and then it's sticking out. So you would know when you did it. I just didn't want you to cut it and then...
Right.
Try to figure out. All right, so we both have our first row finished. So do you remember what you need to do before you start your next row?
Kind of flip it in a quarter turn.
You got it. And then, how do you decide where to start?
You can do four back like this.
Or in this case, because there are three at the shortest part, I just go back like that.
Okay.
Whatever's easiest. Now, the second row, I don't feel the need to have the clothespins, so I'm going to take them off. Now, the only reason I'm continuing to use this great big long piece is... All right, hang on, I'm going to stop that thought. This is where I ended that last row, so I'm going to secure that and make sure that it doesn't just fly apart on me. And then reshape that, pull this a little tighter if I need to. The main thing is you need to control the basket. Don't let the basket control you. So we are back to the beginning now. And this is where I started on the outside. I don't have to worry as much about this coming apart now, so I can just count. One, two, three, and at the fourth one, it's cut almost in the middle. That looks really loose over there.
Yeah.
Don't be afraid to go back and tighten something if it looks too loose. And when your basket is still pretty straight up and down, it shouldn't show that it's going to be really loose or really tight. What Edie did here, she counted over before she got that in place. So take your clothespin off first and really get that where you want it. So if you have to tighten that a little bit, you might have to. You see that bulky clothespin raised it up.
Gotcha.
Okay. Go around and straighten them if they are doing that lean to thing.
Okay.
Yeah. Then the next thing we have to do is get rid of this wobble. Weeble wobble. We covered that. Remember that you need to clothespin where you ended that so that you don't just pop it all out. And then you can just go around like this and just gently push up on that bottom. Push down on that. If you want to, if you're having trouble getting it to go in like that, you can use the back of your scissors like that. Or if you have a little hammer of some kind, you can hammer it. A lot of people use a hammer on a larger one and they just really have to bang it and bang it to get it to pop up. So now, no weeble wobble. Okay, so go ahead and weave two more rows. And remember to check, since you picked it up and did something differently to it, remember to check for that last row where you started and stopped so that you don't do that in the same place again. Because it is September now, even though it's not the official start of fall yet, it is for some people. And Edie and I have both decided that we're going to weave some fallish
colors
into our basket. And
I think a lot of people start decorating fall right around the 1st of September. And
now see, what I think would be really cute is to make this basket, only make the bottom, like the base, about 7 inches. So you could make a much bigger bottom, which would require more spokes. Obviously, if it's going to be bigger, you have to add more spokes in, which we might just do that in another class. And then have it shallow like this, or just a little bit taller than this, and put orange, purple, and black for Halloween candy.
Yeah.
Put Halloween candy in it.
Yeah.
Alright, I
love that. That'd be a good idea.
Our colors are over here. My daughter-in-law and her friend came over last year around this time, and they made Halloween candy baskets with
those
colors. They were really, really cute.
I bet.
I think we have that on our list to teach that class. It's just, it's going to come after many, many more. We decided to put some green in here with some bittersweet, some orange, and some real pretty light brown, and a little pop of red. Would you look at that? Now see, if you wanted just a real shallow basket like this, then you wouldn't have to have your spokes as long to start, and then you would just end it. I made baskets for a group of people that wanted little candy baskets for favors for a gathering they were having, and they were just shallow, like little baskets like this. Okay, so I'm gonna take this one because it's shorter, and I'm gonna have to splice it.
Okay.
So I don't want you to have to splice yours.
Well, thank you.
You're welcome. We cover the next step, which is the twining. We cover this very thoroughly. And you want to make sure that you're not starting on the side where you started and ended. So just
really should have kind of done
like
there.
Across.
Yeah.
Okay. And then you put one under one of the under ones. Yep. And then one under the other one. And now, and now is when you're going to do a step up when you get back to the beginning.
I'll have you refresh my memory on that.
I will. It's kind of a hard thing for people to catch on to at first. And after you have done it enough times that you can recognize if you have them next to each other, then it's much easier to see. Plus, the addition of using a clothespin on the one before you start on helps, because then you know where to stop. Okay, so, alright.
Did I do that correctly?
Right, but you want to have, we'll have the clothespin on this one.
Okay.
Alright, so the one that you start on, you have your clothespin to the left of it. After you go under the one with the clothespin, then you're going to go over that one and under that one before this one. I call that follow the leader. So the one in the front gets to move before this one. And then you don't have those two running together. They're split up. Then you go back to doing it the way you were before. Which is kind of like Yep. Okay. It's like leapfrog. Okay.
And that's the one that's on the under. I do that too.
Yes, after you go under, when you get back to the beginning.
Okay, I'll do that again, see if I remember.
When I first learned how to make baskets, we were not doing this so much. And see, here I am coming here.
Yes.
This is the one with the clothespin. So after I go under the one with the clothespin, I'll hold on to it and then go under that one. That's the key. When you go under, just keep weaving
with it.
All right.
Gotcha.
Okay, that's the trick.
Okay.
Now I'm back to the beginning.
Okay, on the second row. And this is where I just keep on a going.
No, you haven't gone under the one with the clothespin.
Oh, this one. This one and keep
on
going.
Now you keep on going with that one. Yes.
All right.
Okay. And then you go under that one.
Gotcha. So are you thinking how many twine rows?
Just two.
Two? All right.
And then you're going to just snip it at the edge, making sure that you do it on the correct ones. It should still show those two. Yep. There and there. Now, there is another video. We don't need our clothespin anymore, so get rid of that. And in one of our short segments, there is a segment on how to add your color to your basket.
Mm-hmm.
And that really applies to any basket you're going to make, unless it has a special weaving technique, like a twill or randing or whatever. But we're just going to... So, you just put the colors in that you like.
Yeah, I'm just going to start and see what happens.
Just see what floats your boat.
So, same thing with this, Cheryl. We're going to turn it a quarter from where we ended our twining. Correct.
Now, one thing you want to watch for
is if it matches.
Right.
So this one's going to need to be on like this. Am I correct? Or
you don't want it to match. You want it opposite.
Opposite. So it's this.
Right. And what I do is I just do my little shortcut thing. And one thing you want to watch for is look and see where you overlapped that row before the twining. And don't start right above that one. Make sure that you're at a different spot. And then I just do this. That one's on the top. I want this one under. And just slide it back. Okay? If you didn't get that, this is where I overlapped the last row. I'm turning it a quarter of a turn. And then I'm just slipping that in backwards. Yes.
Okay.
You got it. I do not tend to overlap my colors as far now. So instead of overlapping four, I'm just going to go one, two. Just because. And I just turn it a quarter of a turn, and I'm just going to weave another row of the same color. Now it's almost kind of looking like it could be a Christmassy basket. With the red and green I have in it. Except I think I'm going to throw some orange in. And you may or may not have missed a little segment that we did about dyed reed. That I do dye my own reed, and I do use RIT dyes. I'm right up there in my kitchen with the countertops covered with newspaper. So one of these days I will have a lesson on dyeing your own reed. It is much more cost effective, especially if you like to put a lot of color in your baskets.
Yeah.
It's a lot less because Otherwise, you're paying someone like me to dye your reed. And plus, you can customize your own color palette and put some brown in there.
Very pretty. I like your colors.
I like your colors too. They kind of match.
Yeah.
Kind of, sort of.
Just kind of let your imagination go wild, your creativity. If you don't like what you've started, you can always take it out and start with a different color.
I think since on mine, since I did two rows of green twining and then two red, two orange, two brown, I think I'm just going to do two more rows in a different color of twining. Ah. So now I have five different colors in there.
I think we have pretty much the same idea. Two, two, and two.
Pretty close. Is yellow a stretch?
I don't think so. I like yellow in fall colors. I think it adds that pop.
Okay.
Just look at sunflowers.
I have a tiny bit of yellow left.
Hi, Missy Dog. We are being joined by Cheryl's beautiful dog, Missy. We are great buddies.
She's been out for a long run with her daddy, so she's panting.
I just have a thought process here.
Okay, well, Brian, do you want some of this yellow or not?
No, I don't think so.
All right.
But thank you for the offer.
Okay, I will stop.
And I'm thinking this is a different color here, here. See, I was thinking.
You might want to pull that row a little bit tighter. Your basket's starting to grow like this. Look. Look. Can you see?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So all you have to do is
take out this.
No, you don't have to take it out. Undo the end. Just put your flip here.
Okay.
And then now watch these. The ones, this orange is on the outside. Watch these move when I do this. Okay.
Yeah, they start kind of.
Yeah, we'll put a clothes pin on that one so it doesn't move. See that gap that
yes.
that created? Then you just go ahead of it. Pull it a little tighter. This is one of the things that is difficult to instinctively know without being shown by someone. Mm-hmm. Luckily for me, now see, we'll cut it off just a little bit, and mm-hmm. that was only about a quarter of an inch total.
But you can definitely tell the difference.
You can tell
yeah.
the difference. So you can tell how it's straighter up and down now.
Mm-hmm.
Now, somewhere in all that, the bottom popped up again. So we'll just... You may not have been as aggressive as... Should have. When you do that, popping up the bottom, make sure that you don't have to be real nice with it. You won't hurt it. Okay?
Okay.
All right, that looks better.
Thank you.
You're welcome. So this looks a little bit like maybe goldenrod.
Yeah.
And so that does fit into that fall spectrum. However, I'm extremely allergic to it, so
it really is pretty.
I don't even like to say the name.
I'm not sure if this is
My allergies have been so bad, and I got my allergy test sheet out, and I'm allergic to like 7 different trees. I'm going to do 2 rows of this, so I'm going to wrap this around because it's a very long piece. That's enough for 1 and 2, so in reality that's 1 row because it's doubled. So don't be fooled if you're trying to measure how much you need for something. Remember, for your round reed, you have to double it. So that's 3, 4. But I would measure it and cut it instead of taking it in the center. Because you're not going to crimp it. You're not going to crimp it in the center. So actually, it doesn't matter. You are going to have it in 2 pieces anyway. Okay. I'm going to look for where I started and stop that one and go on to the next. Next slide. So if you do it in that one long piece, like I did, like I'm doing this, you can see how twisted it gets.
I get real careless with my reed, so sorry. I just kind of drop it on the floor next to me, and then I have to go digging for it.
So now if I want to bring this in tighter, this is an opportune time for me to do it with the twining, because you can pull on it a little more. You can kind of see how those spokes will pull in. Or you can push in like this if you want. So if it's tending to grow outwardly, you might want it that way. A lot of people like to make more like a flower type basket that just kind of flares. Alright, see, I don't mark mine anymore because, and you just went over 2 right there.
For heaven's sake.
You're not ready to count to 2. You only get to count to 1.
I'm just going to start all over.
Over 1, under 1.
2.
You'll get to count 2. Over 2s when we do triple 20.
Yeah. I remember that being quite... I like twining.
I
tend to make mistakes because I think I'm going faster and you just kind of do your thing. But I really like twining. All right, so this is the one before. Mm-hmm. That's the one before, correct? That's the one before.
Yes.
Okay.
No. That's the one you started on.
Okay, so
it's behind that one.
Yes, so it's right here.
That's...
So this one will go wee-hee.
Yes, wee-hee.
Wee-hee.
Or it might go woo-hoo. So it just depends on who your favorite musician is to whether you say woo-hoo or wee-hee. I think that is
really pretty. I really like it.
This one was flaring out a little more, and I brought it in some with the yellow because it was just getting a little too out of hand for me. I'm not sure how much of this I have left. When I weave this again with the natural, I want to make sure it matches this natural. So it's going to be a little bit different.
Snip, snip.
Snip, snip. Now, Edie, I want to point out something. Usually, when I start color or when I end color, I want it to be opposite of that natural row before.
Okay.
Except in the instance where you use an even number.
All right.
And we used 6 instead of 5 or 7.
Right.
Okay. So this time, if I only looked at that row of weaving and I took it under, it follows the pattern of the Weavers, but it doesn't match the pattern down here.
Of the natural.
Right.
Okay.
I tend to want to be a little bit more symmetrical sometimes.
Okay.
I'm asymmetrical as well. Mm-hmm. But in this case, I'm going to make the natural match
all right.
the natural. When you make yours,
okay. you can, I think I'll follow suit because I kind of like that look better.
Well, especially when we're playing euchre, you better follow suit.
Yes. For those who don't play euchre, oh my goodness. It's a great game.
We have a euchre tournament coming up at work.
Really?
But it's real different. You don't play like with partners and play a whole game and then change table, change partners, whatever. Uh-huh. You start with, they match everybody up. You're only a number. You're reduced to a number. You're not even a name anymore. So you're a number. So if we're number one or two, then we're going to play against number three and four. But we only deal four hands. So whatever points you get,
that's what
four
you get.
Hands, that's what you get. Then you move, you change tables, and then you might be playing two and three might be playing together.
Gotcha.
One and four.
Okay.
And so on. And then you play, we're going to have to see how many games we can get in during our lunchtime.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but
yeah.
four over four?
No,
or just
two.
We can do two?
Just okay. two. No, yeah,
that
don't
sounds
interrupt
fun.
Me. I'm talking about fun at work, right?
That is fun. I kind of like to do another. Remember how we used to do that monthly? Get together monthly and have little door prizes and
card club.
Yeah, I think we need to do that again. I miss that. It's a lot of fun. Just to get together with some friends, you know, male, female.
And I don't want to make this one as tall as this one because I'm envisioning some fall foliage in here. Mm. And so I'm just not going to make it as tall. Plus,
right.
I'm out of half inch. So, that's all I have. I don't want to put more. I'm ready.
And you know what? I'm thinking the shorter basket, too.
So, I'm going to weave that last row on. And it is a quarter of an inch. It's narrower because it's going to be hidden underneath the rims. And then I'm going to go back to inside. I show this in a really easy way to get a nice flush cut here. Just like when you install your carpet or linoleum, you cut through both pieces at an angle. And if it cuts off a little too long, which it typically will, you can then go back and match that up. You probably can't see it up close, but you can see it up close in the detail.
In the how-to, yeah.
In the how-to.
And so, any time during the basket that you're weaving along with us and you're thinking, I can't remember, you got to remember I have Cheryl right here at my disposal. But for you, you have the how-to videos that you can pause and go back, refresh your memory, do it step-by-step with that, and then catch back up with us.
You may notice, if you recall the cutting and tucking,